Mirage is such a good title for an Assassin's Creed game. The prominent imagery that it inspires of a hazy desert oasis fits perfectly for a game designed to try and recapture the ephemeral nature of the assassin and steer this franchise back to its roots. This, the latest installment, arrived on the 5th of October 2023, with copies available for PlayStation 4, 5, Xbox Series, Xbox One, and PC. Interestingly enough, this launched with a pricing model that puts the standard edition of this game firmly under the modern AAA norm. This game is set in Baghdad, 861 AD, which is 330 years prior to the original Assassin's Creed game. This was a period of instability for the Abbasid Caliphate, and Mirage reflects some of that real-world history throughout the duration. This game begins by invoking a strong but short cinematic, blending the series' scientific imagery alongside sweeping shots of the city, layered with the narration of William Miles, a prominent character in this franchise. The player soon takes control of Basim, a thief who dreams of changing the world for the better. You then get the basic gameplay tutorial, an attempt to steal the contents of a box in the Caliphate Palace that has been protected by the mysterious Order of the Ancients. This all feels very familiar if you've played one of the more recent Assassin's Creed games, but you have to set the stage, and this does that. Fairly predictably, Basim's plan goes awry, and he ends up fleeing with Roshan, a member of the Brotherhood of Assassins.
I'm giving you a second chance. Take it.
What stands out here is the contrast in facial detail when comparing Nihal and Basim, and the difference is obviously apparent. This helped contribute to an unbalanced start, which does thankfully get better. What follows this start is a slow and thoughtful delivery of how Basim trains to become an assassin. There's a montage, and he gets his real character model. His facial detail increases massively, and seems to look younger too. It's at this point you also unlock weapons and combat abilities, and are given a purpose. Shortly after this, you're back in Baghdad to investigate the Order, and this is where the game begins for real. The story that comes forth from this isn't anything special. It's going to help if you have some prior investment in the Brotherhood versus Order conflict, but all you really need to know is that they are your enemy. This story has its ups and downs over its 20-hour runtime, but everything follows a very familiar formula. Find links to uncover one of the Order members, and eventually cut the head off the snake. These elements don't stand out, but they were structured in a way that made sense. What didn't make sense was this game's finale. I'm not going to present footage of it here for obvious reasons, but there's a real messy feel to this. After the finale, I spent another 6 hours cleaning up side activities to see if any of these would fill in the missing pieces. They didn't, and this ended up being a fairly simple 26-hour platinum that I kind of did on autopilot while trying to stretch my playtime out. What I did enjoy throughout this tale were the nods and fragments of real-world history that are dotted around this city. As someone whose main exposure to the city of Baghdad is through Western news reporting, I liked reading these and learning a bit more about this part of our planet's history. Some of these come on the back of the story, others through exploration, but they're nice additions for those seeking them. In a similar vein, this game has two languages fully voiced, Arabic and English. I launched the game with the Arabic lines and the subtitles, so I intended to play the rest of the game that way. Arabic voice acting isn't something I've come across in a game before, and I was kind of excited when I downloaded the audio. What stands out very quickly is that this lip-syncing was clearly meant for the English track and the English track only. This was quite unexpected, to be honest. A lot of effort went into putting quality Arabic language voice acting into this game to try and get an authentic experience, and this stands out as a bit of a missed opportunity. That's not to say the lip-syncing in the English is amazing, by the way, it's just noticeably better. When it comes to English voice acting, there's one casting decision that really did stand out, and that's the addition of Shore Agdashlu, who lends her tones to Basim's mentor, Roshan. This character is a seasoned assassin, who has almost become the human manifestation of the Brotherhood's goal and purpose. She's calm, composed, and cold to perfection. And if you're familiar with Shore's performance in The Expanse, this is a very similar character. The rest of the cast around Basim serve purposes, but they never strike you as perpetually relevant. Everyone who comes in and out of the story feels like they'll exit in a few chapters, or even a few moments, and they won't truly matter. The same can be said of your marks too. While the game does show you some of the events of their tyranny, and makes efforts to prove that they're worthy of dying on the business end of your blade, there is this feeling that you're only ever getting their character summary, rather than learning enough about each of them to call it development. Gameplay here revolves around the usual Assassin's Creed features, with parkour and stealth at the forefront. Running on the ground feels quite sluggish and heavy, while running along the rooftops and jumping into different parkour animations is fairly fluid and free. These are a little slower than I remembered in the other Assassin's Creed games, but this system is just as solid as ever. You can find yourself caught in some awkward animations as you jump, particularly if you don't get your angles perfect, but it is more than functional. I'd like to see traversal redone from the ground up for a future game, as this is starting to feel its age, but in this game, designed to harken back to the series' roots, this was the right decision to leave it as is. Once you've made your way to a location, it's time to do your job, and that usually includes making your way through the guards to your target, whether that be an item you need to retrieve or a person that you need to take care of. There's a detection meter, stealth attacks, and melee combat, and this melee combat is very reminiscent of the early games. It relies heavily on a counter-first system, where you parry your enemy and then take advantage of them being off balance to go in for the kill. If the goal of this was to invoke this style of combat, it didn't miss the mark too much. It can feel fairly farcical that the enemies tend to just queue up and wait for their turn to be swatted aside though, and the stamina bar early on is your only real challenge. Once you learn not to spam the dodge button, that factor doesn't remain relevant either. Of course, this is a game about assassins, and it's always better to catch your enemy off guard and go in for a stealthy kill. To do this, you get a handful of tools that you can use to aid yourself, and these range from throwing knives to smoke bombs. These were positive, if not groundbreaking, additions to the game, and I liked upgrading these and switching their functions. You can make your knives dissolve the bodies of your foes, so you don't need to clean up after yourself, or you can turn a smoke bomb into a deadly gas cloud. These represented meaningful progression into how you could play, and my only criticism is that replenishing these was a relatively expensive endeavor compared to the amount of money you naturally acquire. This system does rely on gathering crafting components, but I never felt the economy here was particularly stingy. You get leather, steel, and components for doing contract missions, main missions, or finding them in chests. You can even just buy them with money. Other progression mechanics include skill trees and skill points. These are not gained via an XP system, and Basim doesn't have a level. Skill points are awarded for finishing contracts, gathering books, and completing missions. You can't grind or farm enemies or activities. You need to complete very specific, discrete actions to gain these. This is fine, but as a result, your rank, which in many ways indicates your power in lieu of a level, is practically irrelevant. I went to the areas of the city rated Assassin at the start of the game, and I honestly couldn't tell the difference between this and the starting Initiate area. These were ranks that aren't backed up by gameplay. While I liked that there isn't a leveling system, and you no longer have to chunk your way through meaty health bars, it did devalue the areas of the city that are supposed to be harder or easier than others. This feels much more like a difficulty plane rather than a difficulty curve. While out exploring this world, you will find new pieces of gear, and then schematics for upgrades. Each item can be upgraded 2 times to a 3rd stage, and the weapons and outfits usually have passive bonuses, like quieter kills or bonus damage. These weren't so powerful that they were intrusive, nor so ineffective that they were irrelevant, and that is a compliment. These allow some customization to Basim's overall style in combat, from giving bonus damage after parries to providing health regeneration. This is one of the better balanced elements of the game, as it's effective but not broken. What's not effective is the decision to include tokens as an additional form of currency. Certain actions in the game, such as hiding in groups of merchants, asking mercenaries to attack guards, or getting musicians to provide distractions, now require an additional form of token currency. These can be looted or pickpocketed, or even gained as rewards from chests. This is entirely unnecessary. And unnecessary really is the key word. I much prefer having to do a side quest to help a specific faction or group and then unlocking this feature, rather than having to worry about a form of currency that is more difficult to obtain. The cynic in me believes that these are padding. The optimist in me thinks this may have just been a misguided way of physicalizing respect as a currency in this world. Regardless of who is right, this was a mistake. One area of Mirage I do want to praise though is the city of Baghdad, and I specifically mean the city. A lot of the map in the wilderness is just large, uneventful space, and while this is a strong contrast to the tightly packed city, it feels wasteful. Outside of a few small towns and isolated locations, there are just expanses of nothing. The city is different, and I think the best example of this is the bazaar. This is a large marketplace and is filled with NPCs that go about their businesses. They run stalls or shops, and you really get the feeling of mingling in with this crowd. As you look around here, you can see the Babylonian-style water and plant life, and the flash of a coin pouch that Basim can liberate. This economic contrast in a boiling pot of crime and opportunity showcases the peripheries of this society, and helps inform a lot of the bubbling discontent in the city. The designers who put these scenes and settings together did a good job, and it contributes greatly towards this game's atmosphere. Stepping back a little, my key takeaway from the first 15 hours was that nothing was truly bad, and nothing was truly good. This game floated firmly towards fine, until I finished and took a second step back. I took a full day away from gaming after getting this game's platinum and collected my thoughts, and I was really, really trying to figure out why this just felt so lackluster. Ultimately, I think it's that this game can't hold up any one key aspect that feels like it was meant to be this game's hook. At least, nothing that compares in the way that Black Flag focused on naval combat, and Odyssey introduced dual protagonists and a Shadow of Mordor-esque mercenary system. I can't point to one significant feature that lifts this game. This theme runs through the side content too, where none of it stands out. Even the Tales of Baghdad quests and the contract missions feel like glorified fetch quests, and were it not for a main mission where Basim has a feisty confrontation with a woman named Marika, I couldn't point to a single quest that I remembered. All of this is a shame, because for someone looking from the outside in, this game generated some buzz and made headlines in the mainstream, non-gaming media. The inclusion of the Arabic voice track is perhaps the biggest culturally relevant step here. But the game also has some decent accessibility options and really tried to sell itself as an effort to go back to this series' roots. Those things sound great in news articles and on the back of a game case, but the reality is that they don't make this a good game. Back to the actual game then, and technically at least, I don't have any complaints. I played the PS5 version of this game, prioritizing frame rate, and this remains strong throughout. I saw a few bugs and glitched NPCs, but nothing that really held itself up as a problem. This did have a couple of graphical hang-ups, like Basim's pre-training character model, but this mostly looked the part of a cross-generational title. Mirage is underwhelming. It had a strong nostalgia-based concept and an attractive price tag, and I went into this with relatively high hopes that it would impress me. At its best, this game generates that feeling of nostalgia. Running across the rooftops and avoiding chasing soldiers, or the moment just before you take down a target where you can just feel the inevitable. These are the best examples of a game that makes you feel like an assassin. This is exactly what the original Assassin's Creed game did so well. What proves to be the ominous haze circling around Mirage's flickering oasis is the reluctant acceptance that while every system here works, none of it ever feels exciting. I've already covered a great deal of this, but this game also couldn't escape the constant barrage of icons appearing on your map, or the repetition of loot chests trapped in similar rooms with similarly barred doors. If you're looking for an additional nail in the coffin, then I can point to this entirely single-player game's microtransactions, but I think I've made my point. The shame is that I occasionally like games of this type. There's something pleasantly methodical about having a series of boxes to check and things to loot. I'm certainly at a point in my life where I understand that there's no need to try and exaggerate something that's just fine into something terrible, or big it up into something amazing. A lot of life ends up being in that in-between area of quiet contentment, and that's usually where Assassin's Creed games are. Even when viewed through the lens of that metric, this one stands out as disappointing. According to my PlayStation, I have 100 hours each in Odyssey and Black Flag. These are the two Assassin's Creed games today I can find strong, compelling reasons to go back and play. Neither game is perfect, but they represent ideas and execution from this series that I just liked a lot better than this. This is sadly more red flag than black, and an indicator of a concept that was severely let down by its execution. In the end, like its namesake, the fleeting moments where this threatened to be a competent and fun dose of nostalgia proved to be naught but an illusion.